إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. O you who believe, be aware of Allah, be conscious of Allah, اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا, and speak righteous words, speak good words, say good. يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ. If you do so, if you have taqwa, and you're conscious of Allah, and you're aware of Allah, and you speak good, Allah will correct your affairs. يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ. Will correct your affairs, will guide your actions, will guide the things that you do to a path which is good for you in this life and the next. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. Before that, and Allah will forgive your sins. And whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger has indeed been given a great victory, a great success. فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا. أَمَّا بَعْدْ. We said that Uthman ibn Affan رضي الله عنه was called ذُو النُّورَيْن, the man of two lights, because the Prophet married him to two of his daughters. He married him to one of his daughters, and then when she passed away, the Prophet ﷺ married his second daughter to Uthman ibn Affan. And he's the only companion to have that virtue. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu has a virtue which is also not shared by the other four khulafa that we've spoken about, and that is his close relationship to the Prophet ﷺ, and being married to the Prophet ﷺ's daughter. So he's already a close relative of the Prophet, because he's the Prophet's cousin. Abdullah, the Prophet's father, and Abu Talib, Ali's father, are brothers. And they were close brothers and full brothers. And hence, Abu Talib took it upon himself to take close care of the Prophet ﷺ, even when the Prophet was much older, because of his closeness to his father Abdullah, and because he's his close nephew. And being related to the Prophet ﷺ is a great virtue for the people of Iman and who do good, and it's useless for people of disbelief and sin. There are some things which are virtuous and noble. If you do good, then Allah gives you this extra virtue. Like seeing the Prophet ﷺ. We spoke a few weeks ago about the virtue of the Sahaba and their great station in Islam. Why? Just because they saw the Prophet? They saw the Prophet as believers and as people who did good. So seeing the Prophet for them raised their rank so high. Abu Jahl saw the Prophet, Abu Lahab saw the Prophet as well, but that didn't benefit them in any way. In fact, there's a Quran that we recite until the Day of Judgment condemning Abu Lahab to Jahannam. Even though he saw the Prophet and met the Prophet, spoke to the Prophet, but that benefited him in no way. The same applies here. Being from the family of the Prophet ﷺ, whether at that time or until today, is something noble and virtuous for the people of Iman and the people of good. And Ali ibn Abi Talib, like I said, as well as being the Prophet's cousin, He's also the Prophet's son-in-law. And that's why when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed some verses of the Qur'an, إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَهِّرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. Allah only wants to purify you, O Ahlul Bayt, O family of the Prophet, and get rid of any impurities, keep any impurities, material or spiritual impurities, metaphysical impurities, keep them away from you. The Prophet brought together Fatima, his daughter, and Ali, his son-in-law, and Al-Hasan and Hussein, and said, "Oh Allah, these are my family. Oh Allah, these are my family." And the Prophet said, and all of these are narrated in the most sound books of hadith, everything that is mentioned today, inshaAllah, from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He says, "La yuhibbuhu illa mu'min." Only a believer loves Ali ibn Abi Talib. "Wala yubghidhuhu illa munafiq." And only a hypocrite dislikes him and has hatred towards Ali ibn Abi Talib, Amir al-Mu'mineen radiallahu anhu. And he was one of the first people to accept Islam. He wasn't the Prophet's son. He was the Prophet's cousin. And so there's an indication there that even though he accepted Islam as a young boy, he did so because of his intellect, not just because he was following what his dad said to him. And so Ali ibn Abi Talib was one of the first people to accept Islam. Some of the ulama even say he accepted Islam before Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And other scholars say Abu Bakr accepted Islam first from the men. But Ali was the first young man, or the young first boy, to accept Islam. And Abu Bakr was the first man to accept Islam. And Khadija radiallahu anha was the first woman to accept Islam. He witnessed the Battle of Badr. And when he stayed behind in the Battle of Tabuk, because the Prophet ﷺ told him to stay behind in Medina and take care of whatever is going on there, he said, "Oh Messenger of Allah, you're going to leave me with the women and the kids? And I want to be with you for every single battle." So he said to him, "Do you not want to be to me like Harun was to Musa? Just like Harun and Musa were like this, do you not want to be the same with me? غَيْرَ أَنَّهُ لَا نَبِيَّ بَعْدِي." Except that there's no Prophet after me. Because the Prophet Musa عليه السلام did a similar thing, where he went on a duty and left Harun behind. So the Prophet ﷺ said to him, "I'm not leaving you behind for any negative reason, but I'm leaving you behind for you to take care of something, just as Musa did to his brother Harun." Ahmad ibn Hanbal and a number of scholars of hadith say, the virtues and the good traits that have been narrated about Ali ibn Abi Talib are more than the good traits of any of the other companions. And the nature of the honest scholars of hadith and the honest scholars of Islam, who make the Quran and the teachings of the Prophet their only guide and their first guide and the ultimate guide, is that they are incredibly objective and fair. They don't say, "Oh, there are some people who love Ali ibn Abi Talib or claim to love him too much, so let's make things up about Ali ibn Abi Talib that are negative or false." They don't hide the fact that a hadith are authentic, talking about the great virtue of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then say, "Oh, we don't want to promote these hadith because there are some misguided people who may, you know, use this to their advantage." No. Islam is not my religion, it's not your religion, it's not Ahmed's religion, it's not Malik's religion, it's not Abu Bakr's religion, it's not even the Prophet's religion. It's the religion of Allah. So our duty is to deliver it and follow it exactly as it comes. And from the incredible traits of justice and fairness of the scholars of hadith is that if a narrator is known to be misguided, but trustworthy. In narrating hadith, Al-Bukhari and the Muslim and the other Imams of hadith will accept their hadith. And if a narrator is known to be a follower of the Sunnah and defending the Sunnah and an Imam and following the Sunnah, but when it comes to transmitting hadith, he's weak, the Imams of hadith will reject that hadith and say this narrator is weak. Because for them, preserving the words of the Prophet ﷺ takes priority. أقول ما تسمعون واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه غفور. الحمد لله وصلى الله وسلم على رسول الله وبعد. We've spoken about Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and Umar and Uthman in previous sermons and previous khutbah. And today we wanted to touch upon the virtues and the role of Ali ibn Abi Talib رضي الله عنه. And one of the traits that are clear in Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, is this justice and fairness and objectivity that I just mentioned now. And that's why whenever he was asked about Abu Bakr and Umar, he always said, there's no one like Abu Bakr and Umar. And no one is equal to Abu Bakr and Umar. Even when he was killed by someone who is from the most ruined of people, because he's killed one of the greatest people on the face of the earth. In fact, the greatest person on the face of the earth at that time. Because when Ali ibn Abi Talib was the Khalifa, Abu Bakr, Umar, and Uthman had passed away. So he's the greatest companion on the face of the earth. This person, Rahman, and his name shouldn't even be mentioned on the minbar. This person who killed Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, when Ali was close to death after being killed, he said, hold on, some of the people around him said, we can kill all of them, all the people who are with him. He said, no. He said, wait, while I recover from this illness, فَالْجُرُوحُ قِصَاصٌ. Then Islam has a way of punishing people who injure. He injured me, his punishment is injury as well. It's not death. And if I die, then his punishment is death. So wait to see what happens to me first. If I end up passing away, that's his punishment. If I don't pass away, then that's not his punishment in Islam. And this attitude of objectivity and fairness is essential for us as Muslims. And in the Muslim community, there's enough disagreement, enough variation, enough sectarianism that harms a person's iman and Islam. And therefore, a person shouldn't be passionate about any person. We shouldn't be too passionate about defending any person. Not the khatib who delivers this khutbah, making everything that he says is perfect, nor being excessively against someone just because you disagree with one or two of their things. But instead being fair and objective. And the scale is the scale of Islam. It's the scale of Allah's book and the teachings of the Prophet ﷺ. What they bring, that's the haqq. Everything else is put through that scale, and then we decide how correct it is, how incorrect it is. Whether it comes from a Muslim or a disbeliever, truth can come from a disbeliever. Didn't the Prophet ﷺ approve the words of the shaytan when he spoke the truth to Abu Hurairah and told him to read Ayat al-Kursi every night? The Prophet ﷺ said, Sadaq, he's truthful, he's right. وَهُوَ كَذُوبٌ. He's a liar, but in this case he's truthful, he spoke the truth. And therefore, like Alqama said, Ali ibn Abi Talib is like Isa ibn Maryam. Some people overpraised him and were destroyed because of that. And some people hated him, so they were destroyed because of that. And if some people overpraise one of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, then the duty of the Muslim is taught not to not praise them, not to love them, and maybe even feel some ill feelings towards that companion. So what if some people are astray? So what if some people are extreme? Our scale is the scale of Islam. If some people over-exaggerate towards a scholar, that doesn't mean you hate that scholar. Judge fairly. Some people over-exaggerate towards the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We're going to reduce our love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We're going to reduce saying sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's a scale of emotions. That's not a scale of justice and fairness and righteousness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali, and allow all of the Sahaba and us to be gathered with them in Jannah, and raise our rank in the dunya and akhirah for our love for them and our desire to follow them. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fill our hearts with iman and knowledge and fairness and justice. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala nabiyyina Muhammad. اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا وعافنا واعف عنا اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين في كل مكان اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين والحمد لله رب العالمين.